He is the truth made flesh, but he is also the sacrifice, the propitiation for our sins, who are unable to keep the truth.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
Well, I've been up since 5:30. Been working on this this study, and there's just so much there that I'm immersed in it, but I'm also in awe of it. And it's about the mercy, which most people call the mercy seat. However, I have found that the word seat is not in there. So that's the first change of thinking that we need to have as a group. But before we go into that, why don't we pray, and then we'll dip our feet into this river of truth. Father, thank you for your word, so deep and so rich and full of life as well as information. You told us that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word. And I pray that we will live today in a new way as we ponder these words that you've put into your inspired book, the Bible. Give me wisdom to teach, and give us all hearts to hear and ears to hear what your Spirit is saying to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, Scott, you have a big assignment today.
All right.
Okay. So if you remember our last episode, we were talking about the ark. And of course, you ended on a very spiritual high note with bringing in Harrison Ford. And
I actually cut that part out. I just edited that last night. So.
Okay. All right. Well, you can leave it in for this one. But I think it is important for us to remember that the ark was in the most holy place. Now, here we are, you know, we're in America, and it seems almost like in a different world, a different time. But this ark was in the most holy place. In fact, I'd be willing to say that's why it was the most holy place, is because the ark was there. It's because the ark was more than a box made of acacia wood covered with gold. It was the place where the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments, the law, the covenant was housed. These expressions, the ark of the testimony is used 38 times. The ark of the covenant is used 43 times. And it's inside this ark. And on top of the ark, we have cherubim, and we have a cover or lid or gold piece that's 2.5 cubits by 1.5 cubits, and it's called the mercy. But it's a holy place, and this is where the priest, the high priest, one priest, entered one time a year. This is the ark that Uzzah touched and died. This is the ark that was moved amongst the five cities of the Philistines and wreaked havoc in their cities and made Dagon, their false god, appear on his face with his hands and head cut off. This is the ark which, when carried by the priests, stopped the flow of the Jordan River. This is something, and I hope that we can have an awe attached to this study as we look at it, that we'll be taking a deep breath and remembering this is in the most holy place, the Holy of Holies. And I want to just say that as I was meditating on this, it wasn't just the fact that there were two tables of stone in there with words that God's finger had written on them. This was a covenant. This was a contract. This was an articulation of a relationship between God and his people. And there's two longer passages. I hope people will just take a deep breath and just soak in. But this law is wonderful. And when I think of Deuteronomy, I think of Deuteronomy 5:29, when God says, oh, that my people had such a heart as this to fear me and to keep my commandments always, that it might go well with them and with their children. This law is God's heart being expressed in words. So I'm going to read a longer passage from Deuteronomy chapter 4. O Israel, listen to the statutes and the rules that I'm teaching you and do them, that you may live and go in and take possession of the land that Jehovah, the God of your fathers, is giving you. You shall not add to the word that I command you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of Jehovah your God that I command you. Skipping down to the seventh verse. For what great nation is there that has a God so near to us as Jehovah our God is to us whenever we call upon him? And what great nation is there that has statutes and rules so righteous as all this law that I set before you today? Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. This is God speaking out of his heart to his people, and he's recording it for them. And this is what is placed inside this golden box. And the seventh chapter brings out a different aspect of this covenant. This is the Deuteronomy 7, starting in the sixth verse. You are a holy people to Jehovah your God. Jehovah your God has chosen you to be a people for his own possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. Jehovah did not set his love on you or choose you because you were more in number than any of the peoples, for you were the fewest of all peoples, but because Jehovah loved you and kept the oath which he swore to your forefathers, Jehovah brought you out by a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know, therefore, that Jehovah your God, he is God, the faithful God, who keeps his covenant and his loving kindness to a thousandth generation with those who love him and keep his commandments. So there's God on one side expressing who he is, what he expects, and he says, and if you'll do your part and love him and keep his commandments, this is what's going to happen. And he goes on, and I don't want to keep going. It's all wonderful. I hate to know when to stop. But this is God making a covenant with his people, and these sacred words expressing his heart are stored in this wonderful gold box, this ark. Now, here we come. So, on top, I'll read from Exodus chapter 37, verses 6 through 9. He made a mercy. And as I said, I have not been convinced by anything I've studied or read that it's a seat. And I don't want to lose the mercy aspect for thinking of it as some kind of a chair for God to sit in. We've talked about this in when Jesus washed his disciples' feet and then he gave the new commandment, and we have lost the new commandment, but we've kept the feet washing aspect. And I want to focus on the mercy aspect and forget the seat. So I'm going to read this without the word seat. He made a mercy of pure gold, 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide. He made 2 cherubim of gold. He made them of hammered work at the 2 ends of the mercy. 1 cherub at the one end, 1 cherub at the other end. He made the cherubim of one piece with the mercy at the 2 ends. The cherubim had their wings spread upward, covering the mercy with their wings, with their faces toward each other. The faces of the cherubim were toward the mercy. Okay, here we're doing our deep dive now. So put on your headgear or whatever and your breathing apparatus. But there are 4 or 5 words in Hebrew that are translated mercy in English. Okay. So I went through these all this morning. I got out my old paper, Young's Concordance, and I went through them and I spelled them out. Chesed, which we've talked about, Raka, Olios, Kanan, and they mean kindness, loving kindness, love, pity, compassion, beneficence, graciousness. And those are totally legitimate and in their context. However, the word that God uses 27 times, 18 of those times in Exodus, 7 in Leviticus, 1 time in Numbers, and 1 time in 1 Chronicles, talking about the temple, the word is not any of those words. It's a unique word. So this word, when we read mercy in our head, as English-speaking people, we're thinking of all these different aspects. He's merciful. He's kind. He's compassionate. And those are all legitimate in their context, but not in this situation. This word is kapareth. It means propitiary. We're going to get to a definition in a minute. Propitiary. It's real close to the word kippur. Now, I hope you're hearing the K and the P and the R in English. But this is kippur, which is used 8 times in the Bible. And each of those 8 times, it's translated atonement. So kapareth, kippur, closely related, they mean propitiary, they mean atonement. The root word for both of these two words is kopher, which means the price of a life or a ransom. And another word closely related to kopher is kafir, which is used 104 times, which means to cover over, to pacify, to make propitiation, to make atonement, to cleanse, to be merciful, to reconcile. All right. So I hope that when you look at the initial word, kapareth, closely related word, kippur, the root words, kopher and kafar, you get a picture. It's atonement, it's propitiation, it's ransom, it's the price of a life. Whew. That's astounding to me because I didn't expect it. And yet what I found, it's so clear that this is what this word means. It's propitiation. It's an atonement. It's an atoning sacrifice. So I looked up some words here just to help us to make sure we're all on board here. I looked up the word atonement. I like the Webster's 1828 old original dictionary. Atonement means the expiation of sin. And I thought, well, what does expiation mean? Expiation means it's expiation for the sins of men made only by the obedience and sufferings of Christ. Another translation for propitiation is the atonement or atoning sacrifice offered to God to assuage his wrath and render him propitious to sinners. And I thought, wow, what does propitious mean? It means favorable, kind, disposed to be gracious or merciful, ready to forgive sins and bestow blessings. So this piece of gold, this mercy, has to do with Christ taking away our sins. It has to do with the wrath of God being assuaged. Okay, now put them together. So you have this ark with the law, the covenant, and right above it, you have mercy. I don't know if you see this connection, but I'm just going to jump in my notes to some things that I thought were just awesome. But it says that Psalm 85:10 says, mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. This is what we see happening in this holiest of holies, we have the truth in the ark, and we have mercy above it. And mercy and truth are met together. I hope this makes you think of John chapter 1, verse 14. It says, the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory is of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. See that? Mercy and truth. John 1:17, the law was given through Moses. The law was given through Moses to Moses, and it was put in the ark. But then it says, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is right there. We're seeing him. He is the truth made flesh, but he is also the sacrifice, the propitiation for our sins who are unable to keep the truth. You know, Paul says in Galatians that the law is a tutor which brings us to Christ. And it's the law that reveals our sin. It's the law that reveals our needs of a Savior. So let me just keep going. I'm on a roll here. Romans 3:21. And listen to these thoughts being expressed here. And by the way, the reason that I'm in Romans 3:21 is the Greek word in the Septuagint that's translated mercy or mercy seat in the King James Version appears two times in the New Testament. It appears in Hebrews and it appears in Romans chapter 3. So let me go to Romans chapter 3. I find this fascinating. I'm going to read this in two different translations. And most of us know Romans 3:23. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Boom. But let's go to the 21st verse to start. Now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a mercy seat by his blood to be received by faith. That's exactly, it's the same word, except most translations use the word propitiation, which we have just defined. So let me read this again in the Amplified Version, just that last verse. Whom God put forward before the eyes of all as a mercy seat and propitiation by his blood, the cleansing and life-giving sacrifice of atonement and reconciliation to be received through faith. Okay, now let me keep going. It gets, if possible, it gets better. Romans 3:25. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he has passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Goodness, I'm ready to start singing the hallelujah chorus here. So he is just. So he's faithful to the box. He's faithful to the ark. He's faithful to the truth and the law and his covenant. But he's also on top of that, he's merciful. He's the justifier. His son has made propitiation, atonement, reconciliation by his blood. And if we believe it, we can come into this Holy of Holies and find true life. Whew. And the thing is, I gotta keep reading. So 1 John 2 says, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the world. And Romans 5:8-11. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore We have been justified by his blood. Much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Whew. I don't know how much clearer it can get between the Old Testament, between the New Testament, between the word itself. I'm going to go back now and read Exodus chapter 25, which I was going to start with, but I couldn't make sense of it until I had this background. Verses 17 to 22, you shall make a mercy of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be its length, and 1.5 cubits its breadth. And you shall make 2 cherubim of gold of hammered work, shall you make them on the 2 ends of the mercy. Make 1 cherub on the one end and 1 cherub on the other end. Of 1 piece with the mercy seat shall you make the cherubim on its 2 ends. The cherubim shall spread out their wings above, overshadowing the mercy with their wings. Their faces one to another. Toward the mercy shall the faces of the cherubim be. And you shall put the mercy on top of the ark, mercy and truth. And in the ark, you shall put the testimony that I shall give you. There I will meet with you. And from above the mercy, from between the 2 cherubim that are on the ark of the testimony, I will speak with you about all that I will give you in commandment for the people of Israel. And in Leviticus 16:2, he's talking, he says, speak unto Aaron that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the face of mercy, which is upon the ark, that he die not, for I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy. So this is Jesus to me. He is God with us. He is the one that meets with us. He is the one that is our Emmanuel. All right. Now, you have the opportunity to respond and represent all the people that are listening.
Well, there's a couple of thoughts that came to mind while you were talking. One is just the covering of the law with the mercy. I'm just looking at it, just thinking of the image of that when you talked about putting it like on top of, like the law is inside the box and it's covered by this mercy. And like, I just quick looked up cover in the New Testament and come with Romans 4:7, blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, for whose sins are covered. You know, it just feels like, oh, it's like, yeah, here's the law and I've covered it.
Yes. That's good. Mercy.
Like that's just so much. Nowadays, I mean, the more I read the Bible, the more I am just hit with how it's all him. You know, we talk about the big players in the Bible, you know, David and Moses and, you know, all these characters. It's like, it's not like they were anything without God doing this. And it's just, yet again, this is just a picture of that. It's like, oh, here's the law. You need to carry it around. But guess what? I covered it with mercy.
Yeah.
I got it.
Amen. I found one more little edifying fact. It says in Numbers chapter 4, this is the service of the sons of Kohath in the tent of meeting, the most holy things. When the camp is to set out, Aaron and his sons shall go in and take down the veil of the screen. Now, we've talked about this veil. This is the veil that separates the holy place from the most holy place. And it says they're supposed to take down this veil of the screen and cover the Ark of the Testimony with it. Then they put on it a covering of goatskin and spread on top of that a cloth all of blue. And all I could think of was Hebrews chapter 10, 19 and 20. Having therefore, brethren, boldness for the entrance into the holy places in the blood of Jesus, which he did initiate for us, new and living through the veil, that is his flesh. And all I could think of was picturing Jesus draped over the ark.
Amen.
Because he is the veil, his flesh. And he broke down everything that separated us from our God. And there's Jesus draped over the ark so that we can be restored and we can come in and find life. I don't know what else to say. How about we pray? Father, thank you that you are merciful and gracious in every way. And you gave those wonderful words. And nobody has a covenant or words like you've given to your people. And then on top of those wonderful words, you put mercy. And mercy and truth, grace and truth, met right there. And Jesus died. He's the one that made propitiation. He's the one that made atonement for us. Thank you for letting Jesus be draped over the ark. We worship you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.